Good morning and welcome to today's service. My name is Jim Wilson and I'm very pleased to have been asked to lead worship here for you today. And I hope that we can come together in the spirit of fellowship and faith to continue the Unitarian and Free Christian tradition of meeting for worship. So there are no announcements today, so we'll begin by lighting our chalice. But I have a chalice reading today, so I'll give the reading and then light the chalice. So the reading is by Lisa Doge, and it's called A Chalice Lighting for Challenging Times. Why a flaming chalice? The question comes. It's a cup of life, we answer. A cup of blessings overflowing. A cup of water to quench our spirit's thirst. A cup of wine for celebration and dedication. And the flame of truth. The fire of purification. Oil for anointing, healing. Out of chaos, fear and horror, thus the symbol was crafted a generation ago. So may it be for us, in these days of uncertainty, sorrow and rage. A light to warm our souls and guide us home. So today, because of the restrictions that are in place, we have recorded hymns. So now that our chalice is lit, we will have our first hymn, which is Here We Have Gathered, which is number 62 in the purple hymnal. So there are three prayers I would like to share with you today. And as Unitarians, we may have different images of God or Spirit or the Divine. Jesus often spoke of the Heavenly Father in ancient times. In other places, people use other words. In ancient China, they spoke of the Tao or the Way. And of course, we may have many different images of God or divinity. And many of us may not even want to have any particular word at all because we think that those things cannot be put into words adequately. But as is tradition in this chapel, I would like to invite us all to recite the prayer that was taught to us by Jesus, the Lord's Prayer. And please join me if you would like to. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Another prayer I'd like to share with you today is a traditional one. It's Psalm 131, which is from the Hebrew Bible, and this is the NRSV version. O Lord, my heart is not lifted up. My eyes are not raised too high. I do not occupy myself with things too great and too marvelous for me. But I have calmed and quieted my soul, like a weaned child with its mother. My soul is like the weaned child that it is with me. O Israel, hope in the Lord, from this time on and forevermore. And the final prayer I'd like to have today is a contemporary prayer which comes from Unitarian Universalist tradition. And it is called Let Us Rest in This Peace by Victoria Weinstein. Spirit of life and love, we have gathered again out of our separateness to know that we are not alone. In our fears, we are not alone. In our grasping for peace, finding it in fleeting moments, and losing it again to some turmoil of the mind and heart, we are not alone. In our cynical moments, our wonderings, is this all there is? Is this the best we can do? We are not alone. In our pain, we are not alone. And so we dwell in you, spirit of healing and wholeness, for this brief time. Willing to be held here in an immense and eternal love, whose origins we do not know, whose reality is irresistible. It calls us on. It reaches between us to fill spaces. It consoles the grieving and it calms the anxious. It gives new vision to eyes dimmed by tears and exhaustion. It opens the ear to deeper truth. It makes a place in the heart as hope. Let us rest in this peace and be held here. For our second hymn today, we're going to hear Come and Find the Quiet Center. So this is number 21 in the Purple Hymnal.
Oh,
So I would like to share three different readings with you today. They're quite brief. The first is part of a diary entry written by a young girl who lived during the Second World War. The second reading goes back further in time and is an excerpt of writings which were inspired by the visions of a Christian mystic in the Middle Ages. And the third is one that's very well known, which is from the Gospels. So the individuals who spoke or wrote down these words all lived during difficult, unsettled times. But they all seemed to find strength, courage, and the sense that all would come right in the end. So the first reading is called I Can Feel the Suffering of Millions, and it's by Anne Frank. I can feel the suffering of millions, and yet, if I look up into the heavens, I think it will all come right, and that this cruelty too will end, and that peace and tranquility will return again. In the meantime, I must uphold my ideals, for perhaps the time will come when I shall be able to carry them out. The next reading is from chapter 5 of the manuscript Revelations of Divine Love by Julian of Norwich. And this is from the long text version. And it's actually a modern English translation by Barry Windyatt. In this vision, he showed a little thing, the size of a hazelnut, lying in the palm of my hand, as it seemed to me, and it was as round as a ball. I looked at it with my mind's eye and thought, what can this be? And the answer came in a general way like this. It is all that is made. I wondered how it could last, for it seemed to me so small that it might have disintegrated suddenly into nothingness. And I was answered in my understanding, it lasts, and it always will, because God loves it. And in the same way, everything has its being through the love of God. And our third reading today is sometimes called The Lilies in the Field, or Do Not Worry. And it's in the Gospel of Luke, chapter 12, verses 22 to 34. And this is the NRSV version. He said to his disciples, therefore, I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat, or about your body, or what you will wear. For life is more than food, and the body more than clothing. Consider the ravens, they neither sow nor reap. They have neither storehouse nor barn, and yet God feeds them. Of how much more value are you than the birds? And can any of you, by worrying, add a single hour to your lifespan? If then you are not able to do such a small thing as that, why do you worry about the rest? Consider the lilies, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin. Yet, I tell you, even Solomon in all his glory was not clothed like one of these. But if God so clothes the grass of the field, which is alive today and tomorrow, is thrown into the oven, how much more will he clothe you? Oh, you of little faith. And do not keep striving for what you are to eat and what you are to drink, and don't keep worrying. For it is the nations of the world that will strive after all these things, and your Father knows that you need them. Instead, strive for his kingdom, and these things will be given to you as well. Do not be afraid, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. Sell your possessions and give alms. Make purses for yourself that do not wear out, an unfailing treasure in heaven, where no thief comes near and no moth destroys. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. So those are today's readings, and I would like us now to have a few minutes of silent meditation and reflection. You may have liked to hold up in prayer someone you know or a family you know that's having a hard time. You may want to just sit quietly, reflect on the readings. Or you may just sit and think of better times and hope for the future. Yeah, so let's come to the end of the period of silent meditation. And we'll have our third hymn in the service, which is, "There is a place I call my own." And this is number 167 in the purple hymn. We are made exactly as God wants us to be. We only need to lift our minds above earth's empty sorrows so that we can rejoice in the divine joy. These are the words of the 14th century English mystic Julian of Norwich. And Julian was an anchoress, which is a sort of a religious hermit. And at that time, anchoresses and anchorites lived in a state of withdrawal from much of the world, And they did this by being permanently sealed into a little cell that was normally attached to the side of a church. Now, we don't know very much about the personal history of Julian, and some have suggested that Julian, or maybe she was also called Juliana, may not have even been her given name. But we can form a picture, an image of the society and times that she lived through back in the 14th century, which included both the Black Death and the Peasants' Revolt. And the fact that Julian's story and teachings were recorded at all and survived to the present day is quite remarkable. And although one version of her writings was published in about 1670, it really wasn't until the 20th century that her work became more widely known, when a manuscript of her writings that was kept at the British Museum was published in 1901. So Julian lived in Norwich, and at the time Norwich was a big city, very busy, lots of commerce. But the Black Death arrived, and that happened when Julian was about 6, and about a third of the population of Norwich was wiped out. And never mind that she lived through such difficult, challenging times, the life of an anchoress was not one that many people would have taken lightly. Apparently, it was common to hold a ceremony for a new anchoress or anchorite that was a little like a funeral, so that before the person was sealed into their room, which would be where they lived for the rest of their lives, they're actually sung psalms for the dead, as they were considered as being dead to the world. However, anchorites were allowed to communicate with the outside world, and typically they acted as a sort of spiritual counsellor within the local community. Normally they were allowed to talk through a small hole in the wall of their cell to any passers-by or visitors. And during the 14th century, Norwich was a major centre of commerce. So in her anchorage at St. Julian's Church, Julian wouldn't have exactly been isolated completely from the world. But the fact that we even know that she existed probably reflects both the impact her words had on those that heard them, and the way that her words were so carefully preserved, mainly by nuns. And in 1414, there's a record that Julian was visited by another celebrated English mystic, Marjorie Kemp, who records that she was going to see Julian, for the anchoress was an expert in divine revelations and good counsel could give. So she clearly had quite a good reputation at the time if people were travelling long distances to see her. Now, clearly we live in quite different times to Julian. But some of the things that society is going through at the moment could say to have some similarities. We're in a global pandemic. I think many of us have probably had some fear of getting sick, of possibly having time off work, or maybe even losing family and friends. And I'm sure many of us have given at least a little thought to what may happen to us if we become unwell. And I'm sure many of us know at least one family that's been affected in some way by what's been going on. And even if we manage to avoid getting sick ourselves, there have been huge changes to many of our working lives, with children or grandchildren not being able to go to school, with having to maintain social distancing, and the possible longer-term impact on well-being in the economy. But having said that, we should probably reflect on how much better our lives probably are than the average 14th century peasant. Especially now that we have modern medicine, and thankfully we now have various vaccines that have been developed for corona, which are now being deployed. So the inspiration for talking about Julian of Norwich today came to me recently, as a couple of weeks ago, when I was feeling a bit deflated. Like many others, my family's had to juggle work, homeschooling, we've been cut off from a lot of our friends and extended family. But during that time, the words that Julian made famous just came to mind. And they are, all shall be well. And all shall be well. And all manner of things shall be exceedingly well. And when I remembered these words, I wondered if there's anything we could learn from this 14th century mystic. I wondered if her words could give us any help or encouragement today. So some of you might know a little bit about Julian, and some of you might never heard of her at all. Absolutely fine. So I thought I'd give a little summary, a little biography. So Julian, what we know of her, had a series of revelations or showings at the age of 30 during a very bad illness that actually appeared to be terminal. And she was so ill that she was given the Catholic last rites, which would have been common at the time, and was given a crucifix to look at and meditate on in the hope that she'd have a good death. However, Julian, although she was in bed and essentially paralysed, had a strange vision, and she had a vision of Christ's passion. And then a series of other revelations, one of which we heard earlier in the reading, where Julian saw that all was made is to God like a little hazelnut, just a tiny little thing. And she wondered how it could survive, and then decided that it must be loved by God and would therefore last because of it. Although Julian grew up in a time when many would have been born into a quite religious society and probably a quite oppressive one, it's not that clear she was particularly committed to religious life before her deathbed experience. In the fact that people come to see her when she was dying sort of suggests that that might have happened before she became an anchorite. But in any case, the experiences that she had led her to develop a great deal of insight and wisdom, which seem, given how her words have been preserved, to have been a great comfort to many people. Especially given the care that was taken to ensure her words were preserved. Now, I probably don't share an exact theological perspective of a Catholic recluse in the Middle Ages, but I do find much of her writing to be very inspirational. Also, having said that, Julian's wisdom in some ways is actually quite radical. And I do wonder whether some of the writings were sort of kept on the quiet a little bit at the time. Julian, unlike many others at the time, said that sin, or going a bit wrong, looking the wrong direction, was actually necessary. It was required so we could learn. And Julian also described divine love as being like motherly love, with God being a mother as well as a father. And the inspiring words of Julian, that all should be well, also led me to think of other inspirational individuals and how those individuals have had experiences of what they had considered to be the divine, or at least have found some sort of sense of love and peace. And also being able to then put down some of their worries and concerns. And even though times have been quite challenging recently, I know that in my case I have found times of happiness and even joy, even if it's brief. But I think what most of us really want in life, and many of us do find, is a feeling of peace, of inner stillness. Now, we don't need to have a near-death experience to find that. Julian did, and I'm sure that others have also. But there's clearly many great spiritual teachers and teachings that have been recorded and made by a series of remarkable people, and those that are less remarkable. As we heard in the readings earlier, Anne Frank, a young girl living in hiding, come up with those wonderful words that point us to the possibility of finding peace and confidence, even when times are very difficult and the world around us is very hostile. And as Unitarians, we may hold a number of diverse views about different faiths, including the faith that Unitarianism grew out from, Christianity. Now, Julian having visions of the Passion of Christ may not resonate with any of us, might resonate with a few of us, but perhaps her teachings on finding love do. In a similar way, Unitarians, Free Christians, have a number of different views about Jesus, the man, and what he represents. And much of traditional Christian faith seems to talk more about the identity of Jesus rather than look at what he actually taught. So I find it really interesting to actually look at what Jesus taught. So laying aside all the traditional theology. Now in my mind, Jesus, like Julian, was also somewhat of a mystic. He looked for deeper meaning. And there are some more liberal theologians, like Marcus Borg, seem to agree with this, and Marcus describes him as a Jewish mystic, and goes on to highlight the symbolic and metaphorical meaning of many of the stories that surround him. But whatever we think, much of what Jesus seemed to teach, much of his ministry, was what he called the kingdom of God, or the kingdom of heaven, which was referred to in the earlier reading from the Gospel of Luke. Personally, I do not take the word God to refer to some sort of supernatural being that lives in the sky. To me, God is a loving presence in which all things appear. It's something that nurtures us and nourishes us. It's also something we live and move in, and I think it lives within us too. And Jesus said the kingdom of God was among us. It was within, and it was at hand. So to me, this doesn't really just suggest that he thought it was the environment he was living in at the time in the Middle East, when he was basically living under Roman oppression. I don't think he thought that environment was probably heavenly at all. Instead, my take is that very similar to that of other contemplatives. I think Jesus was talking about finding a sense of loving presence that we can experience now. A place of love, if you will, where there is a sense of being connected to the divine. And I think other spiritual traditions also point towards this feeling of divine love and the sense of peace and assuredness that it brings to us. As we heard in the reading from the Gospel of Luke, Jesus recommended that we should strive for the Father's kingdom and be like lilies growing in the field. We can be nourished by the earth and bathed in sunlight. Jesus also pointed to the treasure of the heart, of love, and not so much the material world. And perhaps if we look for this loving presence within ourselves, we may find a small sense of love that grows and spreads, much like what I think Jesus is referring to in the parable of the mustard seed, where he talks about the kingdom growing from a tiny seed into a big plant. which apparently mustard seed gets everywhere, it's quite invasive. Jesus also talked of the kingdom being like a valuable treasure which we should sell all our worldly possessions to obtain. So I'd like to suggest that this loving presence of God or Spirit, or even just the word being, if that works better for you, can be found in times of great difficulty. We heard this earlier in the words of Anne Frank. And since, although Anne Frank is clearly remarkable, she did realize this at quite a young age. So I don't think we need years of learning or study. We don't need to be experts in theology. We don't need to have theological arguments. But I think we can agree, or at least try to see, if we can find that sense of inner stillness and inner peace. And in any case, my hope is that we can find the kingdom of God, or a place of love within, and that, as Julian says, all will be well. Amen. So our final hymn for today is The Lord's My Shepherd, and this is number 66 in the Green Hymnal. So, to finish today's service, there'll be some music. And I think it'd be a good time just to have a moment just to recognise all the great work that was done by Captain Tom, who sadly passed away last week. And before we listen to the music, I'd like to share with you a benediction by Maureen Killeran, which is called As We Listen to the Blessing of Music. So as we listen to the blessing of music, may we know this ending as more than a time of goodbye. May the warmth of this community and the memory of our chalice flame sustain our hearts and encourage our minds as we engage the blessings of life's challenges and joys. The service has ended. Your service has begun. Go in peace, go in joy, and go in love. And this one's for Captain Tom.
Blue sky and sweet silver song of your laugh.
Walk on,
walk
through
on
the wind,
through the wind.
Walk on through the rain,
through the rain.
Though your dreams be tossed
and blown.
Thank you so much, Tom.